indeed Africa will be saved. Good morning, good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. And indeed, even today, we shall still rejoice and be glad in this day. It is indeed my pleasure, my honor today to have been risen up this morning to come and worship. And that is why I would not lose an opportunity to worship God, even in difficult times, even in difficult situations. I am currently not in a proper space where I can be able to play the music as loud as I can, as I would want to, and dance before the Lord as I normally do. But I said, regardless of the circumstances and the situation that I'm faced with, I will not lose an opportunity to worship God. And having said that, let us go into the next song while we're still waiting for others to come through. This is the day indeed that the Lord has made for us to rejoice and be glad in it. And we shall indeed worship Him because He is the only one who can save Africa from what it is going through. indeed yenuya katala ngami, and I know for fact that he cares for me, for he says that I must cast all my burdens unto him, for he cares for me, and I know indeed he does really, really care for me, and he cares for you too. And as usual, you know that our worship, even though it is in song, in a song or in song, we often have a scripture that we read from in order to base our worship upon. And our scripture today, it is taken from Isaiah 59. And this is a message about what separates us from God. But I would want to read the whole of it so that we understand what separates us from God. But the emphasis that I would want to put on today's worship, it is God's declaration. After all that he has mentioned that separates us from him, then he makes a very, very encouraging declaration. Let us go through the scripture, therefore, and read. I will not be fast. I won't read fast so that you can follow and get to understand every word that God says. It is these things that separates me from you. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. That is the opening statement by God. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. But your iniquities have built barriers between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he does not hear. For your hands are stained with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, and your tongue mutters injustice. No one calls for justice. No one pleads his case honestly. They rely on empty pleas. They tell lies. They conceive mischief and give birth to iniquity. They hatch eggs of vipers and weave a spider's web. Whoever eats their eggs will die. Crack one open and a viper is hatched. Their cobwebs cannot be made into clothing, and they cannot cover themselves with their works. Their deeds are sinful deeds, and acts of violence are in their hands. Their feet run to evil. They are swift to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are sinful thoughts. Ruin and destruction lie in their wake. The way of peace they have not known, and there is no justice in their tracts. They have turned them into crooked paths. No one who treads on them will know peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not reach us. We hope for light, but there is darkness. For brightness, but we walk in gloom. Like the blind, we feel our way along the wall, groping like those without eyes. We stumble at midday as in the twilight. Among the vigorous, we are like the dead. We all growl. We all growl like bears and moan like doves. Oh, and moan like doves. We hope for justice but find none, for salvation but it is far from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. Our transgressions are indeed with us, and we know our iniquities. Rebelling and denying the Lord, turning away from our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering lies from the heart. So justice is turned away, and righteousness stands at a distance. For truth has stumbled in the public square, and honesty cannot enter. Truth is missing, and whoever turns from evil becomes prey. The Lord looked and was displeased that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man. He was amazed that there was no one to intercede. So his own arm brought salvation, and his own righteousness sustained him. He put on righteousness like a breastplate, and the helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garment of vengeance, and wrapped himself in a cloak of zeal, the covenant of the Redeemer. So he will repay according to their deeds. Fury to his enemies, retribution to his foes, and recompense to the island. So shall they fear the name of the Lord, where the sun sets and his glory where it rises. For he will come like a raging flood, driven by the breath of the Lord. The Redeemer will come to Zion, to those in Jacob who turn from transgressions. If we turn from transgressions, thus declares the Lord. As for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit will not depart from you, and my words that I have put in your mouth will not depart from your mouth, or from the mouths of your children and grandchildren, from now on and forevermore, says the Lord. Says the Lord, that his words will not depart, his spirit will not depart from us, and his words that he has put in our mouth will not depart from our mouth, or from our children's mouth, or grandchildren's mouth, from now and forevermore, says the Lord. It is good that regardless of the situation that we have created, with many activities that we have, our country has been engaged in. The first and foremost, we have distanced God from us. This thing of constitutionality, of the unconstitutionality of making prayers or assemblies at school, distancing God from schools because it is unconstitutional to pray. When we used to pray during the apartheid era, we used to pray at schools. There was nothing wrong with it. Today, there's something wrong about it. It is the first thing that we did. You see, the Americans, even though they may be shrewd and in everything that they do, we might see and judge them as a shrewd country. God is blessing them because first thing that you must notice with Americans, it is their money. It says to God, in God we trust. We don't have any declaration even in our constitution that talks to God, us trusting in God. You see. But Americans have that in a very important tool of survival. Money, their money declares God. Go look at a dollar and check a dollar. The dollar says, in God we trust. The second thing is that we have been very much engaged in many things like blasphemy. We have been using God's name in vain, which is against God's commandment. Thou shalt not use my name in vain. We have the third thing, we have created idols out of those that we follow as leaders. We are no longer worshiping God, but we're worshiping God through Papa. Go deep, Papa. Go deep, Papa. We have made idols and gods, little gods, of those that we are following. Instead of them being humble servants of God, they have become something as our idols. We even hang their pictures on the walls of our houses to show that this is the person that heaven talks to. This person, we talk to heaven through this person, and yet we have missed the point of therefore. In fact, therefore, we have missed the point about Christ's crucifixion, the message of the cross, which dealt away with middlemen, saying now we can communicate with our God directly. We have missed that. And then the fourth thing is that we have blood in our hands, as the Bible says in Isaiah 59. It says our hands are full of blood. We have killed innocent people in this country. We continue to kill innocent people in this country. We harbor thugs, murderers in our homes. And by virtue of that, we have become accessories to the deaths and crimes committed by those that we shield and harbor. Even if it is our brothers or our fathers or our children, we are therefore party to those crimes that they are committing. Secondly, in terms of the blood that we've shed, we have killed people from foreign lands. And if you were to read the Bible about how God hears the cries of those that are in the foreign land. Remember when Israel was in the foreign land, God came to Moses and he said, I have heard the cries of my children. God does that. God does that. Hi, my baby.
Hello, Daddy.
Yes, my baby. You done with your...
Yes.
Test. Okay, I am in the middle of a worship. So you will bear with me, my baby. This is my daughter. She was writing a test. That's why I'm here in this space that I cannot play my music as loud as I would want to. So yes, we have killed foreigners in this land. And we have killed innocent blood of people who were merely just seeking for life, seeking to earn a living, seeking for protection away from their own countries where they were scared of dying. They came and died in our land. That on its own, I remember that Archbishop G.Z. Botswana talked about how God avenges for blood. He personally does that. He doesn't send an angel of death. He doesn't send anybody to avenge for the blood. Their blood speaks volumes to God. And anyone who has killed and never repented will stand the judgment of God. That is why the Bible says, if my people who are called by my name should humble themselves, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, and pray unto me, he will heal the land. We need to repent. We need to repent. We may not have been party to the killing of those innocent people directly, but us watching, the church watching and not speaking against us. The church standing, having to, you know that people who trust God, they are like warriors of God. We were supposed to stand up and say not in our name. But instead we ran away and hid ourselves in our homes. Whilst little kids were being burned alive. I won't forget that video clip that I received, and I regretted why I did indeed go through it. Because what I saw was very animalistic and inhumane. There's no any person that deserves to die like that. No one, especially if it is a child. And with women standing around ululating, seeing little boys being burnt to death alive. We have blood in our hands. We need a serious cleansing. We have departed from God's word. We have departed from the truthfulness of God's word. His commandments, we say them. But we say them like this particular scripture says, that we plea. We rely on empty pleas. We tell lies. We are conceived with mischief and give birth to iniquity. So there's nothing of ours that we do that produces goodness. In the name, we even go into establishing churches in the name of God for our own ulterior motives, and to become gods. A land that is full of gods, God will punish it. He doesn't care. God doesn't care that you are my children. But if my children, who are called by my name, cannot humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, God will punish. But indeed, we are grateful that God says at the end, he declares that, as for me, this is my covenant with you. He is declaring, it is God declaring that he has a covenant with us, says the Lord. My spirit will not depart from you. His spirit will not depart. And my words that I have put in your mouth will not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouths of your children and grandchildren. Thank God that he has spared his spirit to be amongst us. For it is in his spirit that we will rise and remember that Africa will be saved. For the mere fact that there are still those purely preaching the gospel of Christ, the message of Jesus Christ's crucifixion, the message of the cross, that the Bible says it is foolishness to those who are perishing, but God's power of salvation to those who are saved. And let us, I am happy to be one of those children, and I hope my dads and my parents' grandchildren will also be this mouth that will say, our Father is alive. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is still alive. My Redeemer lives, for he says he knows the plans he has for us. And those plans are not plans to harm us, but plans to prosper us. It is the one that I believe in, that he shall in due time, what the Bible says, in God's fullness of time, he shall indeed come to our rescue. When the enemy comes like a flood, he says that he shall raise the standard. Come out of her. That's his word, saying, come out of her. Come out of Babylon. Let us get out of Babylon. During this lockdown, during this COVID-19, let us come out of this Babylon. For this Babylon, it is not good for us. Let us preach the gospel and win souls, because it is in many souls that have been won back to Christ that our country will be salvaged, that our country will gain its sanity. We cannot live in a country that has blood every day, that sheds blood every day. There's no single day without a report of murder, rape, murder, you know, all these things. I mean, things that we are doing that are very animistic. We are indeed approaching the level of Sodom and Gomorrah, that we know what happened to it. Babylon, we know what happened to Babylon. Let us pray today 7 times. It is my prayer today. It is in my spirit today to say, let us pray today 7 times, like Abantwana Power Israel, when they walked around the walls of Jericho. Seven times praying to God and saying, God, let these walls tumble down. Let us do that today. Let us honestly go into this prayer mode today and pray seven times so that our God can hear us and come and save us from this. We cannot kill the future of our children. We cannot let the future of our children die in our hands. Let us go into another song and praise him, for he is good. Let us worship him and pray seven times today. Let us keep to that. It is a prophetic word that is coming into my, that God has put in my heart. Let we pray seven times in resemblance with what they did against the walls of Jericho. He is faithful indeed.
Divine.
Well, time and again, visitation, so faithful. He is faithful indeed. We cannot deny the fact that our God is faithful, for he has shown us faithfulness. For the mere fact that he is still talking to us, it means he hasn't abandoned us. And indeed, it is true that his spirit is still with us. For the mere fact that he still has, you know, certain people talking and preaching the gospel of Christ in its purest and simplest form, it means that God is still with us. He has not abandoned us indeed. That was Vicky Villagas saying he is faithful. And having done so, having gone to the through that song, I will go on to another song and then get into our prayer as we play the song. And the song is Iwe Yehova by Pastor Dagada, Lufuno Dagada. Bible says that we should pray for our government. In the midst of all the challenges, the first point of contact, it is our government. And our first point of prayer today shall be towards our government. For God says he's the one who places government, and therefore it is his responsibility to see to it that our government is in line with his will. Let us pray that our government should return back indeed and say Africa must be saved once again. So in light of that, let me go into this particular song, which was sung by Mary Makeba and Lady Smith Black Mambazo. I think it was with also Paul Simon.
Mm-hmm.
And we thank you, Lord. Once again, we come before you, Jehovah. For there's no other God but you alone. You alone deserve all the glory. We humble ourselves, Lord, before you, seeking your face, pursuit, turning away from our wicked ways. For we are the people that are called by your name. We are your children, Lord. And we know, Lord, that you are Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and the end, and everything that is in between the beginning and the end. Every tongue shall confess, and today the tongues are confessing that you are indeed the King of Kings. Our knees are bowed before you, Jehovah, for it is in you that we can get salvation. We are made righteous through you, Lord. We bring forth, Lord, our government, our president and the cabinet, the entire cabinet, and the parliament in its entirety, Lord. Let you be the one also who orders their footsteps. Let you be the one, Lord, who declares and pronounces certain things on their behalf. Let everything that they say, Kosi, that they think, that they decide, Kosi, be guided by your Holy Spirit. This day, it is the day when we're returning back to you, Nkulunkuluam, as your prodigal sons and daughters this morning. We thank you, Lord. We abide by your rules and abide by your commandments. Teach us, Lord, to do your will. Let your will be on earth as it is in heaven. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty, wonderful name. Amen. Having done that, I think I can go back to Jerusalem. Because the Bible says that we are heading towards Jerusalem, where the streets are made of gold. The earth is our stage to practice what we will be doing in the third heaven, in paradise. Heaven help us all. Thank you. Jerusalem ndiyakulangazelela. It is indeed through this crucifixion, his crucifixion, that we are hopeful of seeing this Jerusalem. We are hopeful of walking through the gates of heaven. We are hopeful and trusting in God, in his mercies that are new every morning, in God's grace that is sufficient, that we, indeed we will join those that the Bible says, obani labo abambethe izingubo ezimhlophe, we will be amongst those, counted amongst those, when we enter those gates and the streets of gold. We shall walk through gold, golden streets. As I said yesterday, people think that, you know, heaven, it will be something that is so different from what we are seeing. Earth is a platform, it is a stage for us to practice what will be happening in heaven. And heaven is physical, it is not spiritual. It is physical. Because the Bible says that when you read about the description that John sees in heaven, where he talks about the elders lying face down, the angels flying all over, saying, the cherubims and the seraphims saying, holy, holy. He alone standing there holding the scrolls. You know, the dead silence when it was asked, who shall we entrust these scrolls with? Who would be able? Who has the authority to open the scroll, which had the plan of life, the seven seals? And it says, one of the elders came to say, when John was afraid and traumatized that there's nobody, there was this dead silence, no one could be found who was worthy to open the scroll. And the elder came to him and tapped on him to say, don't despair, that the Lamb of God is worthy. That is why the angels are singing, worthy is he, worthy is the Lamb of God. He is holy, because he has the scroll in his hand. And he knows every part. And in God's fullness of time, he shall indeed come rescue us and be with us to govern. He is still coming back to govern. The Bible says he's still coming back to govern with us. After all the trials and tribulations that the world will have gone through, blessed are those who are lying in the Lord, who have died in the Lord, because they will not experience the wrath of God. What the challenges, trials and tribulations that Revelations talks about reveals that they are still coming. We've seen a number of those things that are happening. The false prophets, to me, I think if I understand it very well, or with my little knowledge of Revelations, I think we are on the fourth seal, because currently what is happening relates to what is talked about in Revelation, and talking about the fourth seal, the seven seals, the book that talks about, the chapter that talks about the seven seals, the seven churches, the seven candles. Indeed, my people perish because of lack of knowledge. It is so true. We perish because of lack of knowledge. But glory be to God, for he has given us, he has given unto us a son who died for our sins, so that we should not perish but have everlasting life. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No one comes to my Father but through me. So if you haven't received him as your Lord and Savior, this is the moment that you need to pray for yourself. As we continue to pray today seven times, we will be praying seven times today. Also pray for yourself. that you be welcomed into the kingdom of God. Be reconnected with your Father who is in heaven. Reconcile with him. For the blood of Jesus was shed. Innocent blood was shed for your sins. So receive him today by accepting the fact that indeed you believe that he died. By believing that he died for your sins and rose again for you so that you can have life. So he has conquered death for you. Not only has he died for your sins, but he has conquered death for you. The Bible says he has the keys to the Hades. He controls what will go into Hades, including the King of Kings of Hades, the King of the Darkness, the Prince of Darkness. He will be the first one who will be thrown into that hell. That hell was made, according to God, he made it for Satan. But it is up to you to choose whether you want to be the one who follows Satan into hell or you follow Jesus Christ into heaven. God doesn't want any soul to be lost to devil. Devil is the only one, as Lucifer, who was dethroned and thrown, and God hasn't forgiven Lucifer. He's the only one who has no share in the blood of Jesus. So choose life and not death. Having said that, I want to encourage you and say, he is still that fourth man that I always hail and said, that's my God right there. The Lamb of Judah. Oh, the Lion of Judah. The Lamb of God. We listen to that contrast. The Lion and the Lamb. In one, he's the Lion of Judah because he's the man of war. He conquers. Whatever he's faced with, he conquers. He's the Lamb. He's the permanent covenant between man and God. The covenant, the everlasting covenant, the blood of everlasting covenant. The Bible says in Genesis is the seed of the woman, Exodus Passover lamb, Leviticus is the high priest, in Numbers is a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, in Deuteronomy is a prophet likened unto Moses. Who is this fourth man? Come with me now. Joshua, captain of our salvation. Judges, he's our judge and lawgiver. Ruth, he's our kinsman's redeemer. First and second Samuel, he's our trusted prophet. First and second Kings and first and second Chronicles, he's our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of broken walls that shattered our lives. In Esther, he's our Mordecai. Job, oh, I know my redeemer lives. In Psalms, he's our Lord and shepherd. Who is this fourth man? In Isaiah, he's the Prince of Peace. Jeremiah, he's the righteous branch. Lamentations, he's our weeping prophet. Who is this fourth man? In Ezekiel, he is a wonderful four-faced man. In Daniel, he's the fourth man in the fiery furnace. In Hosea, he's the eternal husband forever married to a backslider. In Joel, he's the baptizer with the Holy Ghost. In Amos, the burden bearer. Who is this fourth man? Do you want to know? Obadiah, he is the savior. Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary. In Micah, he is our messenger of beautiful faith. In Nahum, evangelist. Habakkuk, evangelist pleading for revival. Zephaniah, Lord mighty to save. Who is this fourth man? In Haggai, he is the restorer of the lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is the fountain open in the house of David for sin and uncleanliness. In Malachi, he is the son of righteous rising with healing in his wings. Who is this fourth man? Matthew, he's the Messiah. Mark, Wonder Worker. Luke, Son of Man. John, Son of God. Acts, Holy Ghost moving amongst men. Romans, he's our justifier. 1st and 2nd Corinthians, he is our sanctifier. Galatians, he is the redeemer from the curse of law. Ephesians, he's the Christ of unsearchable riches. Philippians, he's God who supplied all our needs. In Colossians, he's the fullness of Godhead and bodily. 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, he is our soon coming king. 1st and 2nd Timothy, mediator between God and men. Titus, he's a faithful pastor. Philemon, friend of the oppressed. Hebrews, blood of everlasting covenant. Who is this fourth man? In James, is the Lord who raises the sick. In 1st and 2nd Peter, he is our chief shepherd who shall soon appear. 1st, 2nd and 3rd John, he is love. Jude, Lord coming with 10,000 of his saints. Revelations, he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. In Moses, he was the rod. To Moses, he was the rod. To Joshua, he was the sun and moon that stood still. To David, he was the slingshot. To Stephen, signs and wonders. To Peter, shadows. To Paul, handkerchief and apron. To Noah, the rainbow. To Gideon, the fleece. To Elijah, the mantle. To Samuel, horn of oil. And to John, the pearly white city. Who is this fourth man? Oh yes, he is the living bread to the bakery. To the banker, he is the hiding treasure. To a carpenter, he is the door. To the builder, he is the sure foundation. To the troubled world, he is the prince of peace. To a student, he is the great teacher. To a philosopher, he is the wisdom of God. To a preacher, he is the word of God. To a hungry soul, he is the bread of life. To a thirsty soul, he is the spring of the living waters. To the jewelry, he is the pearl of great price. To an architect, he is the chief cornerstone. To the dark world, he is the light of the world. To sacrifices, he is the blood of everlasting covenant. Who is this fourth man? He is a father to the orphans, husband to the widows. To the travelers in the light, he is the bright and morning star. To those who walk in the lonesome valley, he is the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, the honey in the rock, the brightness of God's glory, the express image of his person, the King of glory, the pearl of the great price, the rock in the weary land, the cup that runneth over, the rod and thy staff that comforts, and the government of our lives, it's in his shoulders. Who is this man? He is Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of the living God, my Savior, my Lord, and my King. He is also your King, your Savior, and the Lord. He can be also your King, your Savior, and the Lord. As we have agreed, we are going to pray 7 times today. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you, ngamunye ngamunye, until Jesus comes to meet with his church, the body of Christ. May you be blessed. May you be blessed going in. May you be blessed coming out. May you be blessed in the land. May you be blessed in the city. For he is good and he shall remain good all the time. God is good. God is good. God is good. Makube njalo ke. Shapukaye bafethu. Injalo lendaba. Let us end.